So can we start, host? Are we ready?
Yes, yes.
Thank you so much.
Please
start. Hello and welcome everyone to this international webinar series part 2, Biodiversity Conservation and Sustainable Development. It has been a long and wonderful journey with all participants and speakers from various fields of biodiversity conservation. And as you know, the genesis of this webinar series was triggered by the very conspicuous healing potential of nature that we all observed during the lockdown phase of the pandemic, COVID-19 pandemic. And so we thought that now, ever than before, we should take up challenges of assessing our own role in biodiversity conservation. And so we are revisiting various tools of biodiversity conservation. In that context, today's sub-theme is classical and applied tools in biodiversity conservation. And we are very, very honored to have eminent speakers with us, Professor Umashankar from Northeastern Hill University and Professor Abhay Prasad Das from Rajiv Gandhi University. And they will be elaborating on such tools that each of us can take up in our cause for biodiversity conservation. With that, I would like to start our inaugural session. And I would like to inform our speakers that we have a large number of faculty participants. We have a large number of UG and PG students and also research scholars. And interestingly, even though small, but quite a number of people from the civil society who are interested in biodiversity conservation. We have participants from all over India, Bangladesh, Nigeria, Egypt, and Australia. And they have been very cooperative and very active in each session in the interaction. So with that, I invite my colleague, Dr. Shongita Gangopadhyay, to kindly come forward and deliver a welcome speech to our eminent speakers, our participants, and our honorable principal ma'am, who has been the guiding force behind this webinar series. Over to you, Dr. Shongita Gangopadhyay.
Thank you, Dr. Ghosh. Can you hear me?
Yes, you're audible. A little louder, please.
Okay. Good afternoon, everyone. On behalf of the organizing team, I take the privilege to welcome all the participants and the esteemed speakers in the third and the concluding day of the International Webinar Series Part 2 on Biodiversity Conservation and Sustainable Development, Issues, Challenges, and Outcomes, organized by the Postgraduate Department of Botany, Brahmananda, Keshab, Chandra College, Kolkata. Today, we have with us Professor Umashankar from Northeastern Hill University, Shillong. He will talk on non-timber forest products. The NTFPs provide the world the vital forest resources like food, medicines, essential oils, spices, resins, fibers, etc. They also play a vital role in providing sustenance and improving the quality of life of forest-dependent tribals and village communities. Hence, these are our national sustainable pride. We are extremely eager to listen to you, sir. You are most welcome. We also have with us today Professor A.P. Dash from Rajiv Gandhi University, Itanagar, Arunachal Pradesh. We will hear from him on the role of taxonomy in biodiversity conservation. Both the topics are interrelated. Since Eastern Himalayas are the abode of innumerable minor forest producers, the taxonomy knowledge of each of the producers is essential for sustainable utilization of these products. Sir, I heartily welcome you today. We are eagerly waiting to listen to your deliberations, sir. Once again, I welcome you all.
Thank you so much, Dr. Gangopadhyay, for that warm welcome speech. And we would like to go open our inaugural session with a speech from our principal ma'am. I invite our honorable principal ma'am, Professor Papia Chakraborty, to kindly deliver her inaugural speech and inaugurate this session. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you, Dr. Ghosh. Today, we are in the ultimate day of this series. This three-day part, we have come to the end part of it, but not the actual end. It is the beginning, where we learn about plants, the taxonomies, and more, the more specific ones who are really engaged or who are really with the plants, who remain with the plants, that is those indigenous people. The indigenous people who are actually dealing with what we will learn about today, that is the non-timber forest products. And that drives the economy of India. So these indigenous people, they are the effective stewards of the environment. And their traditional knowledge, their resilience and creativity that they employ that in the ecosystem, and they inhabit with their lands and territories, which contribute to the resilience of these ecosystems. So we'll learn about this and the non-timber forest products, as we heard just now, what they are and how they are really the pride of India, where the Eastern Himalayas, where the whole of the plant world maximally lies in the Eastern Himalayas. Today we'll deal with it. And I welcome Sir Professor Umashankar Dikshit and our very own Sir Professor Abhay Prasad Das, who actually, he was the one who had inculcated the taxonomy, the learning approach of taxonomy amongst us when we were his students. So I am really thankful to Sir that you are here, and in my college you have come and you are delivering this lecture, and my students will be benefited also with this. And I welcome you, Sir, once again. And I welcome the participants who have been with us throughout this series and are learning all the outcomes. And of course, they'll have a goal how to go for sustainable development and biodiversity conservation methods, practices, and outcomes. So thank you once again. And I thank the organizers, my fellow colleagues of the Department of Botany, who has been relentlessly working on this webinar series, and my students also, who are helping them out with all these arranging all these webinars. So I welcome all participants and I welcome you all, sir, speakers. Thank you.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for setting the tone for today's session, for your inaugural speech, and kindly be with us as always. And we move on to a very interesting facet right now. Our students have been very enthusiastic about this entire series. They have been cooperating and facilitating in many ways to make this webinar successful. So today they are trying to share their experience of the various facets of Botany Department, which aims at making a holistic development for each and every student of the department, so that in future they become responsible citizens and make positive changes in the world and not only in biodiversity conservation. So here I have Mr. Rishin Bhattacharya from Botany Department, Brahmananda Keshab Chandra College, presenting his experience of the various endeavors that Botany Department takes to build warriors of biodiversity and responsible citizens for tomorrow. Over to you, Rishin.
Thank you, ma'am. Am I audible?
Yes, you are audible. You can start with your
Thank slide. You, ma'am. A very good evening to respected guests and esteemed professors. This is Rishin Bhattacharya, an undergraduate student of the fifth semester, Department of Botany, Brahmananda Keshab Chandra College. I would firstly like to thank my teachers for creating this wonderful platform and giving me this opportunity to put in front some of our departmental activity highlights. We all know that all work and no play makes Jack a very dull child, and our teachers ensure that we don't become one. Combining fun learning of the subject along with numerous co-curricular activities help us to mold.
Yeah.
Sorry.
You can continue. There was a network issue.
Yes, ma'am. We all know that all work and no play makes Jack a very dull child, and our teachers ensure that we don't become one. Combining fun learning of the subject along with numerous co-curricular activities, our teachers do best at what they can do best for us. We have always been encouraged and guided in a holistic approach whenever needed to mold ourselves as a complete human being. Let us now take a look at some of the encouraging initiatives undertaken by our department under the supervision and guidance of our teachers. I would quickly just share my screen. Ma'am, could you just enable the screen sharing mode, please?
Yes, host, kindly enable screen sharing.
It's enabled.
Okay, it's shared, I think. It's shared.
Yes, ma'am.
I'm just interrupting you, Rishin. In case you have any problem screen sharing, kindly let us know. We will do that for you.
Yes, ma'am. Currently, I'm having an issue with the screen sharing. I don't know why it's not working.
Can I ask Dr. Gongopadhyay to kindly share the screen for Rishin? Is that possible, ma'am?
Okay.
So you can continue your narration, Rishin, since we are very short of time. Yeah.
Firstly, I would like to start by saying that our student body did not stay stagnant during the quarantine period and indulged themselves into celebrating the World Environment Day on the 5th of June with the active support of our teacher body. Our students also happened to reach out to educate and enlighten the common mass on the efficacy of household plants and how they could prove to be potentially benign in battling the new novel coronavirus. And a video was uploaded on the same on our YouTube platform. What we are looking at are the screenshots of the video. Our department was also inspired by our teachers to go green on the World Forestry Week from 16 to 20th July as they fired us with enthusiasm, which resulted in an exhilarating outcome. And the entire department celebrated the nemophilist in us. We again can see our teachers extend their philanthropic side to the fire victims of a nearby slum, which was adopted by the NSS unit of the college. Ma'am, can you please move on to the slide where it shows the pictorial representations of the things that I'm mentioning?
Yeah, I'm doing that, but it's not visible.
It's not showing.
Slides are not visible. No, slides are not visible.
It's not moving.
No, not at all. It's not moving. It's stagnant.
Okay. Should I share the screen for you?
Okay,
yes, ma'am, please.
I've stopped sharing.
All right. I'll do that for Rishi.
Okay.
Rishi, you can start. You can start now.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you. Firstly, I would like to say that our student body did not stay stagnant during the quarantine period and indulged themselves into celebrating the World Environment Day on the 5th of June with the active support of our teacher body. Our students also happened to reach out to educate and enlighten the common mass on the efficacy of household plants and how they could prove to be potentially benign in battling the new novel coronavirus. And a video was uploaded on the same on our YouTube platform. What we are looking at are mere screenshots of the video. Our department was particularly inspired by our teachers to go green on World Forestry Week from 16 to 20th July as they fired us with enthusiasm, which resulted in an exhilarating outcome, and the entire department celebrated the name of a list in us. Again, we can see our teachers extend their philanthropic side to the fire victims of a nearby.
Just hold on, Rishi. SPG, can you mute your audio, please? Yes, Rishi, continue, please.
Yes, ma'am. We can see our teachers extend their philanthropic side to the fire victims of a nearby slum, which was adopted by the NSS unit of our college. Now, moving on to the pre-lockdown activities conducted, our student body was asked by our teachers to bring about some students from nearby schools on the National Science Day, which was conducted on the 28th of April, and try to give them a first-hand experience about biological sciences who do not seem to have the privilege of working in a fully equipped laboratory. Our PG students also presented papers at India Biodiversity Meet at ISI Kolkata, which we can see here. Also, our college has mingled in intercollegiate literary fests, which shows that our department is not just STEM-driven, but also has a creative outlook as we bagged the third prize in the competition. Our teachers also arranged for a student workshop by Professor Dr. Ruma Pal of Calcutta University and the research scholars under her, where we as students benefited immensely as they demonstrated experimentally some of the interesting aspects of our subject. Our students also had shown a wonderful portrayal of the creativity in the form of art, dance, photography, etc., which were inspired directly as well as indirectly by our student and teacher body. Our college also celebrated the sports day and the teachers day every year, where we see our teachers becoming one with us and participating with equal enthusiasm, much to our delight. Our teachers also kept contacts with our ex-students and maintained the healthy bonding of the present with the past student body. They also interacted with the student alumni and kept in touch with them to keep alive the beautiful relationship. Lastly, I would like to conclude by mentioning that our teachers also arranged for a parents-teacher meeting to keep the parents informed about the academic arena of our PG as well as our UG students. Thank you.
Thank you, Rishin. That was excellent. You can switch off your video if you want to. Thank you so much for sharing your experience. And you just gave us hope that each and every student in this webinar it can be a warrior for biodiversity conservation as well as a responsible citizen. And it reminds me, as Richard Bach used to say, who is to credit for a glory? Who is to blame for a tragedy? Who can make a change anytime we wish? Yes, it's only you and each one of you. With that, we move on to our first technical session. And I invite my colleague, Dr. Dinesh Haldar. Sir, are you around? Dr. Dinesh Haldar, to kindly introduce our very illustrious speaker for the first session, Professor Uma Shankar from Northeastern Hill University. Professor Uma Shankar, I'm sure he's around. Could you kindly switch on your video?
Okay.
Sir?
Thank you, Dr. Ghosh. Am I audible?
Let sir come.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Can you see me?
Yes, sir, we can see you.
Okay.
Dr. Dinesh Haldar, kindly introduce sir to our audience.
Am I audible?
Yes, sir. A little closer to your speaker. To your speaker.
Okay.
Yes, sir. That's good, sir.
Okay, thank you. I have the pleasure and honor to introduce our eminent keynote speaker, Professor Dr. Uma Shankar. Professor Shankar is a field biologist.
Sorry to interrupt you, sir. Kindly hold the speaker.
Okay.
Close to your mouth. Yeah. That will be good, sir.
Okay. Professor Shankar is a field biologist and a faculty at the Department of Botany, Northeastern Hill University, Shillong. His principal research specialization is in the plant ecology with focus areas such as ecology of pristine and distributed ecosystem, agroforestry system, seed ecology and nursery technology, extraction of non-timber forest products, and sustainable use of biodiversity and its conservation, plant reproductive strategies, and finally, database development. Professor Shankar has guided 7 PhD students and 32 for MSc projects, and currently 4 students are pursuing PhD under his supervision. Besides, he is also hosted and guided 4 Science Academy summer fellows. Professor Shankar,
can I interrupt you, Dr. Halda? Can I interrupt you? Can I take up from here?
Yes, yes, you got.
Thank you so much.
Okay.
Continuing to what Dr. Halda has said, there is a little sound problem. I will just again brief a little bit that sir has been teaching in Northeastern Hill University, Shillong, since 2001 and 2. His principal research specialization is in plant ecology with focus areas such as ecology of pristine and disturbed ecosystems, agroforestry systems, Jhum and Twangya, seed ecology and nursery technology, extraction of non-timber forest products and sustainable use of biodiversity and its conservation. He is also very much interested in looking at plant reproductive strategies and has been working in this area consistently. He has also recently developed a database program on Northeastern biodiversity. Professor Shankar has guided 7 students for doctoral degree and 32 students for MSc projects. Currently, 4 students are under his guidance for their doctoral degree. He has also hosted and guided 4 Science Academy summer fellows. Professor Shankar is a life member of several scientific societies in the country. Earlier, Professor Shankar spent his career at many reputed institutions. One of them is the University of Massachusetts, Boston, in 1996. He has also been awarded with many awards, such as the INSA Young Scientist Medal in 1999, the CESTUP Young Scientist Award in 2002 from the government of Uttar Pradesh, and DST Boys Cast Fellowship in 2003. He has been an honorary fellow of the Ashoka Trust of Researchers in Ecology and Environment, A3 Bangalore, 2002 to 2005. He was selected as fellow of the National Institute of Ecology in 2006. He was a recipient of DBT Overseas Fellowship Award in 2010-11. Recently, he has also been selected for INSA International Collaboration Exchange Program 2018. Congratulations on that, sir. Wonderful achievements. He has 80 research publications to his credit, including an edited book and 2 edited abstract volumes. He has more than 1,100 citations to his publications and an age index of 18. That is highly appreciable. Professor Shankar has completed several research projects funded by DBT, MOEF, CC, and others. And right now, 3 more projects are undergoing under his guidance. So that's a very illustrious background, and we are so humbled to have you with us today. So, sir, the stage is open to you. You can start with your presentation.
Thank you, organizers. Namaskar, first of all. And I thank from the core of my heart all the speakers who have made this seminar begin for today. Of course, this is a series, and probably, as I heard, this is the last day in the series for the current endeavor. And it is a beginning, as said by Dr. Sangeeta Gangopadhyay in the beginning. Dr. Papya Chakravarti, Rishin Bhattacharya, Dr. Dinesh Haldar, and Dr. Vishwarupa Ghosh. I thank you all for a very illustrative introduction of mine, which probably I do not deserve. Okay. I would like to, in the beginning, thank you all for inviting me for this presentation today and considering me as a speaker in your celebrated seminar series. It's an honor to me, to be very frank. And I think that I will be able to do some justice at least to the theme which has been provided to me for my talk. I don't know whether you can see my screen now. Can you see my screen, please?
It is coming, sir. Just a minute. Yes, now it's visible.
Sir. Coming?
Yes, sir.
Okay, fine. So the topic which has been provided to me is related to non-timber forest products, which we call in short as NTFPs. When I was asked then, I was thinking that how to begin with the topic, because NTFPs are something which is in the in my mind and heart for more than two decades, actually, when I started my research on some forestry investigations, but then on the way got into some research on non-timber forest products of India, especially in South India, actually, in the state of Karnataka, in 1990s, 1992 onwards. And that afterwards, I left somewhere for last 10 years, not much I did, but then something or other has been happening. In short, I may say here that Dr. Vishwarupa Ghosh, who is convening the seminar, has also worked on non-timber forest products in Meghalaya with me as my PhD student. So seven, which she counted, she is one of them. So I am having pride in saying this because she is convening this seminar, and when she invited me, I could not say no, because that was the first invitation from her and her college to be a speaker. So despite my some other very, very important occupations, I could not say no. So
thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much.
I am here. I will try to give you some overview and some historical background of the NTFPs in India, actually. As we know that most of the papers, people, seminars, they discuss NTFPs with the notion that NTFPs are something which are destroying the forest and are not good for conservation of biodiversity. There is another school of thought which thinks that yes, NTFPs may or may not be sustainable and may or may not be good for conservation of biodiversity. So there is some sort of positivity. But then there is another school of thought which thinks more positively that NTFPs can actually be an opportunity for conservation of biodiversity. So there is a gradient in thinking process of the scientists from very negative to quite positive. So this is where it is there now, because when we started work 30 years ago and in India, and people were working abroad also in other countries, that time this kind of research was very new, actually. But now we have learned a lot about NTFPs, their extraction or collection from the forest habitats, and then their sustainable harvest levels and marketing. And some information is available with respect to many of the items which are extracted from the forest habitats as NTFPs. Are all products of forest NTFPs, or only some of them are there? This is also a matter of consideration, actually. So I will take you to a journey little bit in the past, and this past is a little bit more deeper into the past, like ancient times. So let's first look at this slide. So how did people live in Yore? And this one picture says all the story, that we were dependent on products of forest, both plants as well as animals, for our livelihoods. And you will see that there is nothing in this picture which is from our modern uses of artifacts. This is another picture. Humans actually subsisted on bioresources completely and in tune with the nature, which you can say as sustainably, right? Then this picture shows that there were some artifacts which were devised and gradual development of artifacts started, although people continued to live in the forest habitats and subsisted greatly on the forest products. This is a picture of some NTFEs from Northeast India taken from a research paper and shows a variety of those. This is just for the purpose of depiction here. Then what happened? Starting from living on the NTFEs, humans started domesticating for crops, for food. Food demand actually was to be met in such a way that NTFEs in many of the geographies could not subsist humans throughout the year. So the process of domestication of crops began. And when it began and more demand increased, people also domesticated animals for plowing as a help for them to reduce labor in the farmland. So that's what happened. And bulls were domesticated. People also started moving from one place to another more frequently than before, and then started domesticating animals for transport. Horse is one example for that, ponies are others. And then gradually people developed in their domestication process and then started domesticating animals for nutrition, say for example, cows, goats, etc. Sheep also. Hence, an ecosystem actually developed. And this is some sort of village ecosystem, which took a shape, took a form, wherein we could see most of the people, they resorted to live near the water resources, either rivers or ponds or where perennial source of water is there. So habitats developed near water resources, wherein the supply of water for a farm was also available. Trees around provided a lot of fruits, and hence some sort of growing of trees of choice near the habitations also started. So that started changing the landscape. Gradually, then people shifted from nomadic to sedentary lifestyle. So colonies developed. People started living in clusters, in groups, and then started interacting with the nature or with the biodiversity in little different ways, wherein they would now need bioresources for construction of houses, actually. Even today, you will see that in India, as well as all around the world, mostly in Asia and Africa, there are many people who still live life in poverty and continue to depend on bioresources for meeting their major needs of livelihoods. So the major portion of the livelihood is still met from bioresources. That may be fuel wood, that may be food, that may be fiber, that may be medicine, etc. So this is what is still the norm in many of the areas which we consider them as backward areas. Okay. This is one example where actually I started my work in 1992 in Karnataka. And this is one community of Soliga tribes in Karnataka. And this comes in the southernmost reach of Karnataka and district Chamrajnagar. Now, earlier it used to be district Mysore, bordering Tamil Nadu. And this Soliga tribe is a prominent tribe which derives most of its needs from non-timber forest products and also collects NTFEs for generating some sort of income to them so that they can meet their need of other products by buying those products from the money they generate from selling of NTFPs. So this is what they have been doing. And that was the time when I started work there along with some of my colleagues. That one NGO was starting helping them. And this has now become a role model for NTFP sustainability in the country, which we will come to later on. Now, from the year to today, how do people live today? How do they go today to the forest? So this has totally changed. We have become visitors to the forest only. And now our lifestyles have changed. Our dependence directly on the raw forest produce has declined. We are urban folks now. This is the place of Karnataka, this is the state of Karnataka in India, somewhere in the south. And this is the vegetation map of Karnataka, wherein Soliga tribe is dispersed throughout within the forest. And this is also a tiger reserve. If you look at the history of classification of the forest produce in India, we will see that actually the forest management, some sort of forest management, which we consider as organized forest management, started in the middle of the 19th century. That's after 1850, when actually D. Brandes was called from Myanmar and he was given this responsibility to manage forests by the then East India Company or British colonialists who were ruling us. At that time, the country was not as one unification, but there were several princes and several kingdoms actually in the country who were ruling in their own areas. Hunting was one of the most important game at that time, and collection of NTFPs was also prevalent. When forest management was started, that was primarily aiming at extraction of timber for various purposes. And one of the most important purposes was laying of railway line. If you remember that India started laying of railway lines sometime in 1853. And then all the tracks used to be made of the wood. And this wood came from the tree trunks. And very sturdy, solid wood was required for that. And that is where all forest management activity started. This was for the transport on the land, terrestrial transport. Parallel to this, there were other needs also for transport on water. And for that, in the dockyards, wood was required for building ships. So these were the major consumers of wood, these two things, which required wood on a large scale. The third, which was added later, was wood required for construction of bungalows for the colonialists who were spreading more in number and in greater geographies, more geographies, especially in cooler places. So wherein a lot of wood was used for building houses. So trees were cut that time also. So if trees have to be cut, they have to also be grown, and that was the very purpose of the forest management at that time. All these activities required a lot of labor. And that is where migration of people was enforced by the rulers so that people from different places were brought to where they were required. Say, for example, Darjeeling. In West Bengal or Shimla in Himachal Pradesh. or Nainital in Uttarakhand. So this kind of immigrations happened on a very, very large scale. And these people were settled and they were given certain rights. So the forests which were virgin and devoid of people, hardly people lived, suddenly had colonies set up. And when people came, they were used for the work of the timber extraction and related works, but were also granted some rights to subsist on the forest produce. And that is where extraction of forest produce started. At that time, forest managers called these forest produces other than timber, generally minor forest produce. That was the time when accounting of the forest produce which was extracted and taken out from the forest started. So accounting started by the Britishers. And this accounting had a very, very meticulous record actually. And some of that can still be found if you go. More than 100 years of records can be found in forest departments of the states. Like I have seen them in Karnataka and West Bengal myself. They have a very good legacy of maintaining forest records. This accounting actually at that time was although mainly focused on timber, but other products were also being sometimes accounted, but not all. So all these activities, when they grew up and then became more, on the other hand, simultaneously, population also rose in great proportions, so demand also increased. And many of the forest blocks were completely clear felled. So when clear felling happened, a forest working plan was also prepared at that time to restock wood in the clear felled forest blocks. And there, those plantations were reached. And then in the plantations, cultivation was also done in the initial years. So that was on the tune of the Tongya plantation systems or Tongya agriculture system, which we commonly call. And this was prevalent in Tarai region of Himalayas throughout. And it was more prevalent in the eastern sector of the country. Timber was accounted also as a forest produce and other minor forest produce. So then there was a need felt for some sort of legislation to stop some rampant or unwanted forest produce extraction by illegal extractors. So first act came into being in 1927, and this was called as Indian Forest Act, in which the first definition of forest produce is given. And you have seen this on this slide, and I will not read everything, but you will see that all the products from the plants were included in this definition. And all the products of the animals also, like tusk, horn, bone, silk, cocoons, honey, wax, etc., also were included in this definition. And not only these bioresources, but also abiotic components of the ecosystem were also included in this definition. These were like products from mines and quarries. So this was a very inclusive definition of the forest produce. But the only essential condition was that the product must be coming from the forest, either found in or brought from the forest. So this was the condition. After that, there were many other acts, which I have just listed some of them here. The most important one was from 27 to 72, in 1972, which came as the Wildlife Protection Act. And further amendments came in 1982 and onwards up to 2010, we have amendments into this. And then Forest Conservation Act of 1980, Biodiversity Act 2000, National Green Tribunal Act 2010, and then recognition of Forest Rights Act 2006. You can add some more here in between. The Prevention of Cruelty to Animal Act also I have added, which is quite old but has been remodeled recently. This is 1960s, which is related to the animals, animal rights actually. So these have been mostly promulgated after India got independence, and then we were at liberty of having acts promulgated. Then there was another development around that time in 1980s actually. And this was a publication which appeared in 1989 in one of the most coveted journal called The Nature. So in Nature, this article was published by Peters and his colleagues. And this was a game changer article in the thinking process of dealing with the non-timber forest products world around. So exploitation of the major soul of the article is written here. Exploitation of non-wood resources would provide profits while conserving Amazon forest. Basically, this thinking, these people were working in Amazon forest in South America. So they did provide data from there. And then they say, yet little is done to promote their development. So the basic theme was that they were arguing like the value of the timber which is extracted from the forest. Okay, they use the term wood, not timber, please notice. So non-wood forest products is another term which is also used, and non-timber forest product is also another term which is used commonly. In India, we more commonly use NTFEs, non-timber forest products, which excludes fuel wood actually. But in non-wood resources, people also include fuel wood. Non-timber fuel wood is included, non-wood fuel wood is not included. Anyway, so this way, their major argument was that the total value in terms of money, the monetary value of the harvest from one unit area of the forest in terms of timber may actually be less than the total value of the non-timber forest products which can be harvested from the same unit area in the long term. Okay, so if I cut 1 hectare of the forest and sell its timber, let's say for X amount of dollars, or if I earn revenue from the collection of the non-timber forest products while maintaining trees intact, then the second one is more than the first one in the long run. Because once I fell the timber, to grow it, we need hundreds of years to the same levels. So total value is more. And this article changed all the thinking process. And they have estimated, actually in their article at that particular time, because the money, the value of money and the currency changes over time. At that time, the timber value for 1 hectare was estimated to be $1,000, okay, US dollars. And based on the estimates of the density, productivity, and market price of each tree, fruit tree and palm, 1 hectare of forest at Mishana produces fruit worth $650 each year. So if you take $650 in the first year, you will get this or around this value next year and consecutively for many years, right? But if you cut the trees and fell timber, then you get $1,000, which looks more than $650 in the first year, but actually for many more years, you do not get anything out. In addition, there is annual rubber yield of $50 per hectare and et cetera, et cetera. So the basic theme was that it appeared more sustainable. You maintain the trees, you maintain the ecosystem, you maintain biodiversity and also earn revenue which is actually harvestable and can be restricted to sustainable harvest levels. So this was one of the game changer article which fueled thinking process of the biodiversity scientists all around the world. Parallel to this, the biodiversity term itself was very new in 1989. Actually, the term has been coined in 1985. And this term was new, and the research on biodiversity was also happening as a new venture. So some funding agencies, especially in the Western countries, were pouring money into research in biodiversity. And then they also got attracted related to this in NTFP research. So all this happened. This was just 3 decades back. Okay. And in these 3 decades, those efforts of funding agencies and of the stalwarts who thought these things for future have yielded a lot of results by now. And we have a lot of studies, thousands of studies which have cropped up from all around the world. But 1990-91, almost that time was one of the beginning years in this kind of research. So we also had, I got an opportunity after completing my PhD in 1991. And in the beginning of 1992, I joined this project in Biligiri Rangan Hills, India, which I showed you the map earlier in Karnataka. And this was also a change for me in terms of my thinking process and also the research which I was doing. I was restricting myself to grassland research for my PhD in Meghalaya, but then I shifted to forestry research immediately in Karnataka. One of the most difficult times which I had was in terms of I not knowing the local language, the Kannada language in the forest, and failing to interact with the tribal people there, Soliga tribes there. So gradually I learned some working knowledge, had some working knowledge of Kannada, which was a Soliga accent of the people, little bit of that. Okay, so this was one of the series of papers which we brought out from our 3-4 years of research from 1992 to 1995. And this was published in this journal Economic Botany from New York. And this is a series of 6 papers actually at that time. And this has been some sort of guiding series for NTFE research. The basic philosophy here was in tune with the thinking, global thinking, that can NTFE collections be sustainable, number one, or are they so in the field, actually in the field? So to judge this, this was a challenge that one has to live right in the forest and watch every day the collection activity of the NTFE collectors and then assess, examine and study those. And this is what was the challenge in front of our team. And then we did it. We lived in forest for many, many days, weeks and months, and then did that. The second challenge was to measure the sustainable harvest levels for different products. And this cannot be done very easily in 1, 2, or 3 years of time. But then we did it for one of the products, which was one of the major NTFEs and revenue earner for the Soliga people. And that was Amla, Phyllanthus amblica. This is the fruit, very fruit from Phyllanthus amblica. Then we also looked at the marketing of the NTFEs, which was prevalent at that time. And Soligas were collecting it. The idea was to assess how much money or return they get by sale of NTFEs to the people who collect it from them. And what is the total price which is appreciated till the time it reaches the consumer? So this also we did. And then we were also interested in the task of exploring the possibility of value addition to the NTFPs. Can that enhance the income of the people to the tribals who collect this? And then, of course, there is the possibility of intervention by technology, which can enhance value addition. So all these were ideas which were around us, and we were just the beginners, and then we started doing research in this. So this, in this particular paper, we have argued that Soliga tribes do not get their due from the NTFE forest. The money, actually, the value of the NTFE, only a portion of that goes to the Soliga tribe, which is very meager, actually. So some sort of possibility of increasing income at the source of collection was there, which has been taken up later in future, and why now they are earning more money. So this was the one of the first results. Then the second was a question posed to whether NTFE harvest affects the forest. This was one of the very important questions, because the people globally who were arguing, as I said in the beginning, from very negative to very positive, some people were thinking that NTFE harvest also have negative impact on the forest. Some people were thinking not so. So that was to be tested in situ, in the field conditions. And this is what we did. We were studying the forest composition and the regeneration of different species in the forest. So what we did was that we selected some sort of settlements of the Soliga tribes within the sanctuary and started selecting the field locations where we could lay our plots for sampling, which were in proximity to the settlements, and those which were away from the settlements. So means distal and proximal, and should be belonging to the same composition of the forest. Okay. Of course, the forest composition changes from one place to another, and that cannot be controlled. But when you increase the replication, that can be controlled statistically to a great extent. So we did that. And then the distance from settlement actually mattered in determining the forest composition. What it means is that the composition, species composition or floristic composition we call, was different in the proximal sites than in the distal sites. So the species which were more resistant to NTFE harvest were more prevalent in the distal sites than in the proximal sites. So this is another publication which came out, actually. Then, as I said, sustainability determination we did for Amla or Phyllanthus amlica, and this is another publication which came out, and this said that the current levels of harvest of Amla in many of the localities were okay. So the variation was there, that how many fruits out of the total fruits which crop up on a tree, how many fruits are to be harvested, so that the population levels of Amla trees in the forest remain intact over long periods of time. So we have determined that the current level of extraction, 60-80% of all fruits at the population, may have a negative impact on the new recruitment, because Amla seed does not easily germinate. Okay, so that is where it was suggested that if you keep your harvest levels below 60% and leave rest on the tree, which will be there in the habitat, will be okay. And we presented a model also for value addition, which has the potential to enhance income of the people and reduce the level of extraction. Means, if you are collecting, say, for example, X kilograms of Amla and earning Y amount of money, right, from the sale of X. If you increase the value of X, by collecting less than X, you can increase the same money, you can earn the same money by the lesser amount. So your extraction levels can be controlled. So that was the idea. I'm having a phone which I have to cut. Excuse me, please, for a minute. So value addition was suggested, and actually in last 2 decades, this has been implemented, and a lot of products from Amla are in market from the Solika community, which can be purchased by you even online today. Then there was another paper which came, this is the fourth one. So the first paper, which was on the extraction impact on the forest composition, was one of the forest types, because this particular sanctuary is a large sanctuary which has different forest types. So in one of the forest types, we tested the hypothesis that the extraction matters on the forest composition. That was dry deciduous forest. And this was scrub forest at the lower reaches or the foothills of the sanctuary, wherein more dry conditions prevail and the vegetation is totally different. It is of scrub type, the shrubby type. Here we found that the large woody species are being replaced by small woody species because of the impact of the NTFP extraction or intervention of the people in the sanctuary. Being at the low foothills and around the boundary on the fringes, interaction as well as the illegal immigration of the people from around of the beyond the boundaries of the sanctuaries was also more. So illegal collections are also more. So that was impacting even more intensely at this place. Then we also looked at some of the biological aspects, that is there impact on the biology of NTFPs because of the biology of some of the tree species because of the NTFP extraction. And then we found that yes, the dispersal and biology of the species which are actually harvested by the people is affected because of the extraction process. So we found that our results suggest that the populations of animal dispersed species, then those of wind or passively dispersed species, are more vulnerable to human disturbance. And in fact, wind dispersed species seem to be facilitated by human disturbances. So this kind of conclusions were there. Then there was a big thought on one of the most important and basic NTFP, which is fuel wood, actually. And this is all around the country. We see even today that many people subsist on fuel wood, without which they cannot cook their food. So fuel wood is important throughout India. And here what we had to do was that we monitored the collection of fuel wood around all the exits of the sanctuary simultaneously, and then collected large scale data. And then found that the demand supply gap was far greater than it actually appeared. So there was a lot of gap. How much time more I have, Dr. Vishwa?
5 minutes more, 5 minutes, and you have interaction followed.
Okay, fine. Thank you. Okay. So this research actually fueled the beginning of the setup of ATRI. So this entire series of papers which you have seen are the progenitors of the foundation of ATRI, which is there today as a prominent world-known NGO. Okay, working research in biodiversity conservation in the country. We have presence in Eastern Himalayas also, in Northeast India also, in Darjeeling and Sikkim also. So Professor Bawa, you can see on the top, is the founder, president. He is the brain behind setting up, and he was also the project principal investigator in which I did this research under his guidance. So he's my mentor and guide. Dr. Siddhappa Shetty was not there in the scene at that time when I was there, but later when I was actually leaving that place, he appeared as a very, very new chair, and then he has taken all this work forward. And now he's one of the most prominent figures in Biligirirangan Sanctuary, and every household of Soliga knows him. Okay, there. Then I came to Northeast India in West Bengal, actually. And as I mentioned a little bit earlier, I found really wonderful records of NTFE collection from Forest Department. And this was one of the papers. We took up Chell Range in the Darjeeling Himalayas, and from where we collected records from 1930 to 1990, 60 years of record I could collect, and saw they completely analyzed the pattern of NTFE collection. So many of the NTFEs which were required for subsistence in 1930s or earlier were not required by 1990. So their collection had been stopped. But some of those which were not required in 1930 were required later on. Or the intensity of extraction declined for some of the NTFEs because they were not in demand, or increased in reverse for some other NTFE because they were more in demand. So that kind of pattern we saw. So this is one article which you can go through. And one of the most important NTFEs of hills of Darjeeling those time, and that is actually broom grass. This I worked on. And at that time, one broom of this grass, Thysanolina maxima, the name is probably now Thysanolina latifolia. Professor Epidas will correct me if it is so. So this used to be 6 rupees, 7 rupees at that time. And when we did work on this, I predicted that the cost of the broom in next 15 to 20 years may go up to rupees 100. Nobody believed at that time. But that actually happened. You buy a broom of this from the market, now it does not cost less than 100 rupees. But then this rising cost also has fueled alternatives. And now you have on your right of the screen, you can see, this is the plastic broom. So people have invented plastic broom. So there are alternatives also. If the cost of the NTFE is rising beyond the level of afford, level at which you can afford to buy actually, then alternatives are invented. And this is one wonderful example of this. Then there were some other papers, I have not mentioned that. But then the idea was something like talking about whether harvest can fuel thinking for conservation of biodiversity. So can we harvest to conserve biodiversity? So this was one of the themes which we have worked on. And then we have to actually see here that the sustainable harvest should not cause any physical damage to the plant, should be renewable year after year, except for variations introduced by the phenological events only. Should maintain the population and natural regeneration process of the target species, should not have any adverse impact on the populations of associate species also, and should maintain the ecosystem functions and should not exceed regeneration rate. So as soon as the regeneration rate is exceeded by the harvest rate, the extraction becomes unsustainable. So that is where we have to take care. Then I also defined alpha sustainability, beta sustainability, and gamma sustainability that can be talked about. Now, we have to move towards sustainability actually. Then what is the scenario today in the country? Actually, I am very pleased to share with you today that as a result of the change in the theme of the forest management after the promulgation of Wildlife Forest Protection Act in 1972 and Forest Conservation Act in 1980, a lot of thinking process and execution on the ground has been remodeled. And now government during last 8 to 10 years, and even today, more and more schemes are coming in this sector. So some revolutionary changes have happened. I am sharing with you some of them. So there are some revolutionary steps by the government of India in this sector, which are towards sustainability. One of the most important ones, which we should know if we do not already, is Forest Rights Act 2006, which is for the Scheduled Tribes or other traditional forest dweller act. What this act did was that it has declared bamboo and cane not as tree. So this classification has a lot of bearing on the collection as well as income generation to the people. Okay, so the categorization of bamboo and cane as trees in Indian Forest Act, which was done in 1927, has changed now after 80 years. And forest people have struggled a lot for this for 80 years because both of these are renewable resources. And the money which can be generated from them earlier was not available to the collectors easily. And this is all about Forest Rights Act, but I will, because of the brevity of time, at last we can say that forest rights of people were defined in India in a proper manner by this Act of 2006. And as a result, it also paved the way for setting up of many sustainable ventures in various modes, including PPP mode also. Okay, so the estimates of the number of people or how many people depend in the country, actually that also varies, but these reports generally mention 100 million people are directly dependent on NTFEs in the country. 100 million means almost 10 crores of the people, and some indirectly means 10% of the population of the country is dependent on the forest products. 100 million is also 3 times of the population of Canada, actually. Then comes, what is government doing for marketing of minor forest produce or NTFEs now? So there are many things. One of the revolutionary change was the central sector scheme of minimum support price. Like from the agriculture produce, MSP is determined for purchase of wheat, rice, maize, etc., potato, etc. But there was no such system for non-timber forest products. So people were being exploited by purchasing the products at a very low price. Now at least minimum support price is there, so they can fetch minimum of that. So introduction of MSP for NTFE protects people from exploitation. There is a portal for this, and this has been very, very recently, just 2 years ago, has been launched by TriFed. TriFed has been completely remodeled, and now you have this portal. And on this portal aims at connecting people, sellers and buyers for NTFE products. And this is just one screenshot of the national portal for NTFEs by TriFed. You can browse through this in detail and find that you can see here something. This is just today I took this snapshot. 1,25,000 artisan families are collected. So this is a story of fuel wood extraction, which I will not get into the detail now because of the time. Fuel wood has been basic necessity to cook food, as I said, and fuel wood collection has been a Herculean task for the people, especially women. So women folk have to carry head loads of fuel wood from distances to home. And they also suffer from the smoke while burning fuel wood in the stoves, chula we call, right? For this, government has already launched a scheme, Ujjala Yojana, distributing cylinders, gas cylinders, LPG. The target has been almost like 10 crore households for this distribution, and which has been quite successful. Many of us have given away our subsidy purchase of cylinders, and then that money has been channeled, and now we have all the statistics. So this is towards freedom from fuel wood, which is also towards reducing the carbon footprints of the country. And that is where we have been arguing in the international fora that we have reduced carbon footprints substantially in the country. There is another mission, Mission Solar Chakra. And this is under KBIC is another. You can go through the website of KBIC. So this is to power MSME. So here, like you have silk cocoons or thread spinning. So this can be done by solar power, and government has a lot of schemes for this. Silk is also a sort of NTFE product. So India also perceived a revolution in honey. Honey is one of the oldest NTFEs ever, which has been a food for the tribals or forest dwellers, rather, I will say, in the Yore. And now we have honey mission, and India perceived this sweet revolution in a very, very big way. And you see, marketing of honey. Honey is very easily available also on Amazon by many of the companies. 20 years ago, buying honey was more expensive than today, actually, if you consider the cost of the honey. And then coming to West Bengal, of course, because you have invited me, I have pride in saying that Sholapith is one of the most important products from West Bengal, the pride of Bengal. And this comes from a plant called Eschinomene, which is a plant which grows in marshy conditions in lower reaches of West Bengal. And this is also one of the world's lightest goods in terms of weight. Okay, so here on the top figure, you can see this is the stem piece, the cut stem, which is the Shola wood. And this is one artifact of the Shola wood. There are some more I have put in. So this is the raw material which is extracted from the plant and then converted. Here it is with the bark, but this is after peeling the bark and so on. And then beautiful and artifacts are made. This also has fueled the art, actually, which survives. So art survives because of NTFE, the Shola. Not Shola survives because of the art. So these are some of the pictures. There are other plants. This is one very good example from the sorghum bicolor. You have jowar, I think this is. So this is made from jowar plant, right? So there can be so many such products which can be sold at a quite reasonably high price in the international markets, and they are being sold also. So I say the grass can be husked, okay? It can be important. This is another one from the ragi plant, Avicennia coracoda, and such a wonderful, useful art form is there. Then we have bamboo mission, which has also been launched during last two decades or so. And bamboo is the lifeline of the people of Asia, actually. And you see, these are beautiful. You can even make a house of bamboo and cane together and live in it. In fact, in Nehu campus, this picture is from Nehu campus, we have a colony of bamboo houses made. And if you do not believe, please come here to Nehu and see it yourself and have a pleasure of living in these bamboo houses for a few days. Then Dr. Vishwarupa Ghosh, I mentioned, has done PhD with me on bay leaf. And here is one bay leaf. Any culinary preparation like pulao is incomplete without bay leaf, the fragrance of bay leaf. So these are some of the items which are there. Now the task ahead, as we are hearing, after our tussle with China, we have to be Atmanirbhar, self-reliant, and we have to revive our toy industry. When I was a child, we used to play with toys made of bamboos and wood. And those have all disappeared. And in fact, we are at a very, very good crossroads, actually, where we have to find some sort of direction from the government and other agencies to revive this, which is coming up, of course. And our toy industry can also be a very, very important revenue earner for the NTFE collectors and NTFE growers. So a lot of toys can be manufactured from the NTFEs. These are just some of the pictures. So Bamboo Mission site is also there. You can see a lot of products. All the paper which we write on has been produced from bamboo, and we use it in our daily life. So coming to the conclusions quickly, India has a long tradition of NTFE collection. The collections have been sustainable for long and have subsisted millions of people. Of late, pressure for cash, income, and demand due to population rise has made some harvests unsustainable. Many items have been domesticated, cultivated, or shifted to alternative products. NTFEs can be turned into silver bullet strategy for harvest to conserve theme. The government has launched many schemes towards sustainability of NTFE harvest and conservation of biodiversity. There is ample scope for revival of art, traditions, and culture, which revolves around NTFEs in India. That's why I say NTFEs are pride of India and can be sustainable. Thank you very much for giving me this opportunity.
Thank you so much, sir. Excellent presentation, taking us through the entire journey from the evolution of the basic non-timber forest products to becoming minor non-timber forest products, becoming marketable. You looked into the harvesting as a sustainable tool, and you have given us so beautifully all the pictures that has revived in us the need and the understanding for the NTFEs, which can actually become a tool to sustainable development, solving the socio, cultural, and economic needs of the people of India. And I'm sure all over the world, as you have talked about the Amazon rainforest. Thank you so much, sir. Excellent presentation. I would like to take only one or two questions as we are waiting for our second speaker to begin. So we have a question from Ravi Kumar Patil. He has written, is there any special privileges and permission for tribal people to collect forest products from forests? Sir, to you.
Yes, they are there. That is why this Forest Right Act has come into being, actually. And this is a boon for the people, which we call forest dwellers, especially the term used as forest tribes. They have been granted rights, actually. It has been recognized for the first time in the country that they have their sovereign rights to collect to certain levels, of course, and certain NTFEs without any hindrance and seeking permission from any of the authorities. So they are there.
So thank you, sir. Could you kindly stop your slideshow? Another very interesting question has come up from Dibendu Kanti Majumdar. He has written, how has the change in forest character by plantation of exotic plants affected the minor forest product?
One second, please guide me how to stop.
Stop
video.
Yes, you just click close the slide.
Yes.
Thank you, sir.
Sorry, please repeat the question.
Yes, just a minute. It's from Dibindu Kanti Majumdar. He has asked a very interesting question. How has the change in forest character by plantation of exotic plants affected the minor forest producers?
That's a very, very good question. I will just give a very, very simple illustration for this. Say, especially in Northeast India nowadays, during last 2 to 3 decades, introduction of rubber and expansion of rubber plantations, especially in Tripura and also on foothills of Meghalaya, I see, maybe other places. What has it done is, it has converted forests into rubber plantations. So the composition of the land has completely changed. The native forest community has changed into mono-specific rubber plantations. And that is where we have lost a lot of biodiversity. And that impacts, of course, the entire ecosystem function. So this is one very simple example, but rubber is an exotic species here. So the question was to exotic species. That is why I took this
example. Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Excellent description of that. And thank you so much for being here. Wonderful journey with you we had today. And kindly be around if time permits for listening to Sir Epidas. You are very well connected with him. I move on to our next technical session. And we are extremely, thank you, sir. We are extremely humbled and delighted to have with us very reputed, well-known taxonomist of India, Professor Abhay Prasad Das. I invite my colleague, Dr. Swapan Mandal, to kindly introduce sir to our audience. Dr. Mandal?
Yes, thank you, Dr. Ghosh. Thank you. It is a pleasure and honor to introduce our sir, Dr. Abhay Prasad Das. He will today enlighten on role of taxonomy in biodiversity conservation, an experience from Eastern Himalaya. First of all, I will say that a long, long way Dr. Sir had traveled and so many prestigious awards Sir have. I would just say a little about Sir's traveling. Dr. Das, our Sir, is now serving as an adjunct professor in Rajiv Gandhi University, Arunachal Pradesh, since September 2019. He is a retired professor of botany, University of North Bengal in West Bengal. He is a fellow of the Linnaean Society of London. He was invited member of Species Survival Commission of IUCN. In the period 1976 onwards, that is up to 1990, he was in West Bengal Education Service. His area of research interest is in plant biodiversity and conservation of RET plants. He has produced 30 PhD in national and international level. He published more than 225 research papers, 16 books, and popular articles over than 22. He was a visiting research professor under DBT at Rajiv Gandhi University, Arunachal Pradesh. He was awarded so many prizes like V.V. Shivarajan Gold Medal, IAAT, at 2001, S.K. Sheth Prize, Society of London, FLS, at 2010, and so many are there. However, we are eagerly waiting to hear our sir's lecture. Please, sir.
Okay. Over to Sir Abhay Prasad Das. Sir, thank you so
Yes, sir. Thank you so much for being with us today, sir.
Okay. And we are looking forward to your experience. You have been endeavoring to make taxonomy an interesting subject, bringing it out of the classroom into the open. And your endeavor has been for many, many years. And we look forward to your presentation today. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
You can share the screen.
Yeah. Yeah. Do you find this?
Yeah. We can see full screen. Kindly go full screen.
Yeah, I'm trying to get. Yeah.
Okay, sir. Yes, it's good, sir. We can see.
Yeah. So thank you very much for inviting me. I am now old man, much older in comparison to Uma Shankar. But Uma Shankar spoke so many difficult things. But I shall speak only very simple things. Anyway, this is just one prelogue, you can say. This is a forest in India-Myanmar border, Nagaland-Myanmar border. Beautiful forest, thick forest, undisturbed forest. And this is one extremely rare plant in Tista Valley, one species of Amoma. And on left-hand side, that is my most favorite wild orchid, Pleon peacox. Now I'm sitting in my Kolkata house. This house is named as Pleon peacox. And on right-hand side, that is the Papilionanthi terrace is abundant in North Bengal University campus. Such a beautiful, you can think what beauty it can add. This has already presented my short CV. So as the talk will cover most part of Western Himalaya, so you are welcome to Eastern Himalaya. ice. Let me start with one small quotation. I don't understand why, when we destroy something created by man, we call it vandalism. Suppose if I destroy your college, then you will say it's vandalism. But when we destroy something created by nature, we call it progress. If we destroy Sundarban and extend Kolkata, then that will be progress. Sorry, I cannot support it with Edward Bigley. I am also asking the same question. So this lecture may be, I do not say that this is the perfect title. You can say that this is role of taxonomy in biodiversity conservation, experience from Eastern Himalaya. So in this lecture, there are three major aspects. First is taxonomy. What is taxonomy? How it can help in our life, in for our survival, everything. Then next part is the biodiversity. And last part is conservation. That is conservation of biodiversity. Suppose you enter the library where the bookshelves are arranged haphazardly. No system, no perfect nomenclature. Will you be able to reach your botany almirah? How will you? It's very difficult. But if there is a distinct system of classification, as most of the libraries have, there very easily you can reach to your place. You can go to botany easily, and you can go to your for which you are searching, and geosperm section very easily. It is not at all difficult. So one classification, one system, that is very important in our survival, in our society, everywhere. Without any proper system, proper guiding force, it is difficult to survive on this. So what is taxonomy? Taxonomy is a subject that deals with the classification, identification, nomenclature, and documentation of different objects. So taxonomy is having first taxonomy proper, that actually control the entire subject. You say ICN or ICBN, that is actually the basic of taxonomy. That controls the taxonomy. Then systematics. Systematics means taxonomy is a subject which has no data of its own. Without data, no subject can work. So taxonomy also need data for its working. And systematics, that provide data. Suppose someone is working on morphology. So he is not working on taxonomy. Your taxonomy practical class are mostly the morphology class. Only the identification part is the taxonomy. So identification, nomenclature, documentation, these are different parts. So how taxonomy can come into the service of our society or everything? So first thing, through taxonomy, we can characterize each and every plant. I am talking about plants. I am a student of plant science, so I shall talk about plants only. So we can characterize each and every species of plant that we know. The plants that we don't know, we have to wait for them. Whenever we shall get a new plant, immediately we shall characterize it. So after characterization, we shall provide names to all these plants, not only at the species level, even in specific level. It helps in classification of plant kingdom so that we can reach one particular category very easily. That is very important. Suppose you enter a Calcutta herbarium. It's a huge herbarium. You know, once it was the largest herbarium of Asia. So in that herbarium, how will you reach to one particular family? How? For that, classification is important. And taxonomy guides to create a classification. Then understanding relationship between different plant groups. We say algae is primitive, pteridophyte or gymnosperms are moderately advanced, and angiosperm is most advanced. How do you know it? We have to determine something, we have to do something. So in that way, understanding the mood of descent, how evolution progressed within the plant kingdoms. In this way, you can think that in every aspect of life, in every aspect of plant science, without taxonomy, you cannot move. You are a biotechnologist, you are a phytochemist, but you need to identify your plant. You need to find out the relatives of your plant. Who can do this? Only taxonomists can do it. Without taxonomy, if your identification is wrong, your entire work is wrong. There are so many PhD theses where the basic material was wrong, but they were awarded PhD. Their publications were there, but basically the entire work is false, wrong one. So this type of records are there. I know one or two cases for PhD itself. So we have to be careful. Yeah, recognition, proper recognition. Yeah, you are going to meet your friend on the road. You have never seen him or her. So if you take a wrong person, that yes, you are my friend, maybe you will get a slap in return. So be careful. Taxonomy is important. Identification is important. Nomenclature is important, without which you cannot survive. See, India is one mega diversity country. You can understand in this list, you can find 17 mega diversity countries so far recognized in the world, out of which India's place is at 7. That means India is very, very rich in its biological resources, both all plants, animals, and microbes. But this classification, this positioning is depending mostly on angiosperms. Here you see, I gave this list. Here you go to India. Here you see, for total higher plants, India's place is 12th. But for mammals, it is 8th. For birds, it is 7th. For reptiles, it is 6th. And for amphibians, it is 8th. You can understand our position. We are so highly placed, our country, and how we are thinking to conserve them. Are you serious? Try to think, try to assess yourself. How much you are serious to conserve our biodiversity? Are you purchasing furniture of smuggled wood? Wood smuggled out from the forest, and you are purchasing furniture in cheap price. If so, then certainly you are not serious to conserve our biodiversity, or to understand the richness of our biodiversity. So India is one biodiversity country. In a biodiversity country, what we need first? We should know what is the actual diversity. How many species of plants, how many species of animals, how many species of different types of microbes are there, their variations. All these things you need to know. Who will do it? Only taxonomists can do it, remember. Professor Uma Shankar is basically an ecologist. Basically an ecologist. For ecologists, it was difficult to identify plants. If you don't mind, Professor Uma Shankar's teacher, Professor Tripathi, I identified plants in his lab so many times. So anyway, that was our relationship. We were helping each other. Professor Tripathi was helping me to understand so many things. Now Uma Shankar realized this thing. Now Uma Shankar is learning taxonomy. So just do biotechnological work or ecological work or any work without understanding taxonomy, it is impossible. But is it essential to know the flora of our protected areas? Yeah, in IUCN guideline, we have reserved many vegetations in different corners of our country. It's a long list of wildlife sanctuaries, national parks, etc. in our country. But for how many national parks or sanctuaries we know the flora or fauna exactly? It is very, very less. Only a little fraction, maybe 5 to 10% maximum, 5 5 to 10% cases, we know the flora. That too is known in very good way, properly. When you enter the forest, what you find? You find there are hundreds of species of plants, animals, hundreds, thousands of species of organisms, etc. For a trained eye, we can recognize this is this family, this is this genus, this is this species standing inside the forest, standing inside the vegetation. We need not to collect them in the laboratory even sometimes, or most of the times. But we take one sample as voucher. With that voucher, we confirm its identity. But you ask one biotechnologist or from any other branch of the subject, enter the forest and recognize the plants, they cannot do it. They cannot even recognize the species on which he or she is working. It will be difficult. So remember, you work in cytology or molecular biology or phytochemistry or numerical or taxonomy, wherever may be. Your best should be strong in taxonomy. Without strong taxonomy, you cannot be successful. That is why I do not like APG system of classification, because it is biased. It is biased on molecular biology. And molecular biology looks very much science, because it uses very costly instruments. If you are not using costly instruments, then you are not a taxonomist. But remember, a taxonomist can use any instrument. A taxonomist can use data from any branch of science. That is interesting. Now, this is our country. In our country, what is the present status of forest cover? They say it is about 21% or so. They say it is increasing every year. I know a little bit of remote sensing. I know how can increase the forest cover just by increasing something, some range. So anyway, this map has been prepared by Forest Survey of India in their Dehradun headquarters. Here you see where is actually rich forest, natural forest in India. It is almost missing, only restricted to some places in some Jammu, Kashmir, Uttarakhand region, some in Arunachal, or means in Northeast India a little bit, some in central parts, some in Western Ghats, some in Darjeeling, Sikkim area. So it is a little bit. Otherwise, so it is reducing, of course, in Andaman Nicobar Islands. So it is reducing almost every day. So it is difficult to conserve them, because our demand is increasing. We need more industry. We need more concrete houses. Then how will you save your forest? So this is the condition. Our conservation strategy will fail if we continue to reduce our forest even after. Now in the now in Facebook, etc., I find one new trend came, the photo taxonomy. Someone is loading photograph and asking for identification, and others are identifying it. And sometimes I start laughing how nonsense type of identification used to come. This is this will happen because you are not getting a chance to study their characters. Without studying their characters, how will you identify plants? So I never support this photo taxonomy. You please try to collect specimen. Try to keep specimens. You maintain your field notebook properly. Then you identify it following the actual method of identification. Now for nomenclature, of course, there are some very good websites through which, when in our time, when we were doing our PhD work, That time I remember we are going to BSI, Central National Herbarium, and whole day going through index QNCs. And if the latest supplement is not there, I don't know how it will do. So this is the condition. But now entire index QNCs is within these things in the plant list or in IPAI or in plants of the world online. A few others are of course there. But one problem, for nomenclature, you can get the updated nomenclature through these websites. But how will you sure that your plant is properly identified? For proper identification, we say we should match your specimen with one authentically identified specimen. For that, you have to go to herbarium. Not just by looking some photographs in Google. In Google, there are thousands of photographs. So many, hundreds and thousands of photographs are wrongly identified, wrongly presented. And you say, yes, I identified it with the help of Google. Remember that identification. For that identification, there is every possibility that it will be wrong. For final confirmation, sometimes we need to match the specimen with its type specimen. Type specimen is the specimen based on which the plant was named at the beginning. The author who named the plant, he used that specimen. So that is the most important specimen, most reliable specimen, because the name is linked to that specimen permanently. But how to get it? Now, type specimens are not given on loan by any herbarium. If you ask Q herbarium to send the type specimen of some species, certainly they will not give you. Now, Calcutta Herbarium is having a very rich collection. I think more than 12,000 species, type specimens of more than 12,000 species are there. But that is not enough. We need type specimens from different herbaria. Anyway, through this plant list, etc., we can go through the new herbarium and can get the images. But again, that problem from images, how many characters you are actually getting? From image, it is not possible to get all characters. So it's a very difficult thing. If the type specimen is there in Berlin Herbarium or Paris Herbarium or at Kew Herbarium, then you have to go there. If it is in Calcutta Herbarium or in any other BSI Herbarium, it is much easier. And students, you are working on taxonomy. If you publish a new species, you must deposit a specimen either to Calcutta Herbarium or to one important BSI herbarium, one specimen, either holotype or isotype, you should submit. But if you keep the type specimens in your university herbarium, and if your university herbarium is not so attractive herbarium, rich herbarium to visit by different peoples coming from different countries, then remember, someday your nomenclature may be ignored. Someone will ignore. So be careful about this phototaxonomy. Don't rely much on images. We need voucher specimens. We need to compare with type specimens. So taxonomists, they do survey of vegetation, record different species. They collect different type of organisms. They understand the population, they can estimate the population structure of different species. They can characterize their habitat. So they know all those things. If you ask me where I should collect this one particular species, I can tell you. You go to this Arunachal Pradesh or Meghalaya, this district, this particular forest, they are in this type of particular habitat, you will get these species. only one taxonomist can tell you, remember. Without taxonomic knowledge, no one can guide you in this way. So remember, you should learn taxonomy first, then think of other subjects. Then, again, there is another problem. Flora of India was there. Flora of British India was there, published during 1872 to 97. Again, government of Botanical Survey of India is publishing Flora of India. And this time it will be much bigger, more volume, many more volumes. Why? Because the flora changes, there will be more records, new identification. For any flora of any place, vegetation is in changing condition. No vegetation is in a permanent condition, permanent stature. That is climax. As ecologists say, no vegetation is in its permanent climax. Today it is looking like permanent climax. But tomorrow, with little change of environment, with arrival of one particular insect or one disease, the vegetation will start changing again. So if we say the climax vegetation will never change, then you are wrong. Climax vegetation will change. That is why we need to look after the vegetation regularly, in regular intervals, you should check it. There is another problem nowadays. There are too much of exotics in our vegetation. Yeah, they are spreading very rapidly. You see, Britishers were very much powerful. That is why they were able to rule over us. But we were weak. Somehow, later on, we gathered our power. We become powerful. When we become powerful, then Britishers left our country. So these exotic species, they are very powerful. They can grow in very difficult conditions, very difficult, they can change the vegetation structure. They can create a favorable vegetation. So we have to be careful about our exotics. Most of our protected areas, national parks, sanctuaries, etc., are now infested by numerous exotic species. We have to be careful. Maybe for the safety of our own biodiversity, we have to change our role. In national park, we may need to remove some exotic vegetation. That maybe we have to think for it. Otherwise, if you say in national park, you cannot touch anything, then maybe after 10 years, 15 years, 20 years, you will find most of the plants originally were in national park has left, gone with the pressure of exotic elements. Now I am in the last part of my lecture, that is the conservation. This is a little longer. Conservation, that means we have to save our biodiversity, all types of biodiversity, plants, animals, microbes, everything we need to conserve. But where they will be conserved? How they we will conserve? You need new areas for the development of your settlement. You need more crop fields. You need more areas to establish industries. You need more hydroelectric power plants. Everything you need. So for that, you need to denude different area. That means remove the natural vegetation from wide areas, so that you can do all these works. Then how will you conserve? It's very difficult. In our planet, no one thinks for survival. Everyone thinks for money. Everyone thinks for comfort, happiness. But this comfort and happiness and money will finally bring you to a dangerous condition where you cannot survive. No one can survive. Maybe one day man will be responsible for all destruction. Anyway, this conservation we generally classify, very broadly we classify in two ways, in situ and ex situ. In situ means where this species is growing, you conserve the area, you conserve the habitat. Let the species to survive in its own home. It may be plant, it may be animal. So you know that in national parks, all plants, animals, they are living together. No one is going to, supposed at least, legally, no one is going to disturb them. But in wildlife sanctuary, suppose a rhino sanctuary, maybe Jaldapara, maybe Kaziranga, rhino sanctuary, where we are thinking for the conservation of rhino. So what we should do? We should prepare, we should modify it in such a way so that there will be more and more rhino fodder production. Naturally, other species will be affected. Vegetation structure will change. And finally, what will happen? That will not match with the area's original vegetation. One day, entire thing will be destroyed. Naturally, you need not to do it by fire or anything. Naturally, it will be destroyed. So this is the condition. We have to be careful, even in our in situ conservation. Let us start with ex situ conservation. This is Kew Garden. Kew Garden, you know, it is famous. So many plants are conserved there. In deeper day, in their hot houses, they are conserving even so many Indian plants. I remember one hot house in Western Australia University. When I entered inside, I found it is too hot. It is just like my country, India. That was in September. In September, this September, I entered this hot house and I found the mango is flowering. One mango plant on a big pot, it is in flowering condition in Australia, just imagine. So they are maintaining many plants. Yes, they are maintaining many plants in different countries, in different gardens, it is maintained. In our country also, there are many botanic gardens, But there are some problems. First thing, we are having at least 8.7 million species on this planet. At least, this is not the final number. There are some estimates which says that there are 1 trillion species. Okay, let us forget about trillion. Let us think about millions only. About this 8.7 million species, of these, how many you can keep your botanic gardens or zoological gardens or your culture media, culture rooms? How many? Because you are affecting the vegetation, you are destroying the vegetation in such condition, how you will keep separate home to these 8.7 million species? Try to think. How many species will grow your garden environment? Can you grow all plants in your garden? You brought one plant. I remember I brought Beauty Formis or Beauty Minor from Ceylon, and Pinus Cassia also from Ceylon. See, Beauty Minor survived in my North Bengal University garden, but Pinus Cassia could not. Why? So many times I brought plants down from Darjeeling, Karsiang, Kalimpong to Siliguri. Most of them failed to survive. more than 90% plants fail to survive. Why? I tried in different ways. I am not so novice to been growing plants, because I am growing plants since my birth. I was having good garden when I was even a school teacher, school student. When I was school student, Kollayan University agriculture faculty students came to visit my garden. That time I was a class 10 student. Just try to think. From that time I am growing plants. So I know how to grow plant, how to acclimatize them. I learned all these things, but I could not grow 90% plant that I introduced. I brought so much, hundreds of plants from Kerala. I have two suitcase full of plants from Calicut University. I brought by air. Just today I packed it. Tomorrow evening when I reached Siliguri, immediately I opened the suitcase. Even then, I could not save most of those plants. Why? That means it is difficult to grow many plants in artificial conditions. Many plants, their environmental adaptability is so narrow. Now you think you developed one project in your university or college or club or NGO based on one project. When the project will be over, who will maintain that garden? Even in forest department, I know so many medicinal plants gardens were developed. What is the fate of all those medicinal plants gardens? Most of those are finished because project is over. There is no money to maintain it. I left my garden at North Bengal University. When I left, that time there were about 800 species growing in the garden. 800 species, remember, collected from different parts of the country, not only different parts of the country, even from other countries. But what is happening there? I think it needs a stock taking. So when a person who developed the garden, who developed that ex situ conservatory, after his departure, what will happen? We don't know. Who will touch these nasty plants? I am molecular taxonomist. I shall do only molecule. I shall think for molecule only. Why should I think for living plants? That is the attitude we have to think. So for our work, basically we do not use sophisticated techniques, but sometimes we need to do. And for some cryopreservation, for gene mapping and gene preservation, today's technique, we say it is most advanced technique. Tomorrow techniques will change. In the accident, your culture is disturbed, your computer hard disk crashed, everything will go. Unless it is left in living condition, you cannot work in future. That is why in our botanic gardens, in our protected such type of ex situ gardens, we grow only some species of special interest. I am working on crotalaria, so in my garden only there will be crotalaria. After my retirement, another student, another teacher came. He said, no, I do not like crotalaria, dendrobium. So he destroyed all crotalaria. Now dendrobium is entering. After his departure, another person will come. He will start working on acacia. So only acacia will come. Then how there will be conservation? Try to think. Only very big botanic gardens can afford some way to conserve a good number of species. But if the number is 8.7 million, how many of this you can survive? Try to think. Microbe conservation is more costly. How to conserve? In atmosphere, there are thousands of species of microbes. How will you conserve them? Now let us see for the in situ conservation. In situ conservation means you are conserving the plants in their habitat. For in situ conservation, IUCN has distinct guidelines. As per that guideline, we are developing different types of conservatories, biosphere reserves, national parks, then your wildlife sanctuaries, reserve forest, etc., etc. There are a number of categories. Yes, we are conserving. Now we conserve one forest. Suppose you look at this. Try to look a little distant. You can see the actual forest of Gorumara National Park, little away. This is the gate. You have to go through this road, and then there will be actual gate for entering Gorumara National Park area. And before that, when you will go on your left hand side, there will be tea gardens. Now in tea gardens, we are regularly spraying dangerous chemicals. We are using fertilizers, is it not? Do you think this will not affect the organisms living in this national park? National park means you need to save all plants, all animals, all microbes, whoever is there, you have to save them. And as a rule, you are not permitted to take out a single dry leaf out of this park. But remember what you do. Actually, our region is floristically so rich. Eastern Himalaya and its foothills, the right dwarfs, entire region is floristically so diverse, so rich. Our country is believing too much in Lord Shiva. You say Lord Shiva is so powerful. I am an atheist. I never think of worshipping any god. But I thought that piece of stone cannot do anything, that it cannot help you in any way. But one day, in Narra Valley National Park, I got this Lord Shiva. Is it not looking like Lord Shiva, your Shiva Linga? If so, then if this is Lord Shiva, then it can do something. Yes, because it is living. It's a plant. It's a plant of Balanophoraceae. Name is given below. Rupalog name is Phalaeoides. So this plant, this Shiva can do something. You can worship it properly. If you can worship it properly, then it can save the biodiversity of its area. Then for worshiping, you need mantra. What mantra you need? Mantra, you need only one thing. Don't disturb its habitat. Don't go there. Don't clean the area. Don't cut any tree. Don't do anything. You just keep it there in undisturbed condition. Then only conservation is possible. So you keep your conservatories undisturbed. How is it possible? How is it possible? We shall keep our conservatories undisturbed. Every day we are constructing new roads inside our protected areas, in national parks and sanctuaries, in the name of better protection. I don't know how is better protection. If there are more roads, there will be more poaching of plants, poaching of animals. It will be easier, poaching will be easier. At the same time, there will be more tourist inflow inside these national parks. Government will say more tourist means more revenue. But try to think carefully. Let us take a different data. How many species is there in Darjeeling district? I spent a major part of my life in Darjeeling district. So let us take a stop. We are going to publish the Darjeeling district flora. For dicot, you see, there are about 2,200 species growing in one district. And for monocot, more than 800 species we have recorded just for one district. So try to think that this much of diversity, how you can protect? Is it possible that if you remove the forest and do all so-called developmental things, no new roads, new townships, etc., etc., this will go. Very soon we are going to publish at least 3-volume work of Darjeeling Hills flora. There, I think you will get these 3,000 species. 3,000 species. Then you will realize what is the richness of the area. But how to save this richness? If you go on exploiting it at every moment, to save this richness, you have to save the vegetation. Without saving the vegetation, you cannot save it. Otherwise, after 10 years, you will find it will come down to 1,000. Now it is over 3,000. Sikkim, very small state, very small, smaller than my original district, Medinipur. Yes? Medinipur, that undivided Medinipur was much larger than the state of Sikkim. In that Sikkim, there are 4,500 species, remember, out of which 658, so far I remember, are wild orchids. Just from one family, Orchidaceae, more than 600 species are growing in Sikkim. Can you imagine the diversity? But where these species will survive? In your garden? People are entering the forest, poaching these orchids and other interesting plants, and they are just sending it to other countries, mostly in illegal ways. This is conservation. This is our ethics to save the biodiversity of our country. It is very difficult. There are ample proofs that new species are there. New species are still coming. Our evolution is in progress. This is just one slide I added here, just to show these are all newly recorded species, newly named species from our laboratory. Suppose the left and upper, my student Lolit Kumar Rai, he named this rhododendron after my name, Rhododendron Abhayi. And again, this Nymphaea, my two students named this Nymphaea after again my name, Nymphaea Abhayana. This is below, this is Globatista. Globatista. Then in the middle, there is Lindania terai. So all these plants we are collecting. This is a very short list I presented here, but this is a very big list. After my arrival to Arunachal Pradesh, we have published a long list of new species. New species means these species were not known previously, but we are recognizing them as new plants and naming them. So it's a continuous process. So now if we destroy the vegetation, where from this will come? Where the evolution will continue its work? Evolution is in progress. It is in action. Don't think evolution stopped. It is in action. One day something will come out that will destroy human, because human is destroying everything. This is some tea state. In this tea state, the central altitude is about, you can consider this is a temperate garden. You look at the center of this garden, in this area, there is a natural vegetation. Suppose a new species originated here. Think, will it be able to come out of the garden crossing through the tea bushes? It is almost impossible. If it is a bird, it can fly. Otherwise, it is impossible. Because regularly we spray so dangerous, poisonous chemicals inside the garden that will not permit any other species to survive inside our tea gardens. We don't want that any other species grow in our tea gardens, survive in our tea gardens. This is the condition. One species cannot migrate. Previously, species could migrate from one place to another species. Across the Himalaya, from east to west, there was migration. Angiosperm originated in Myanmar-Arunachal border, but it reached Europe. How? Through this way, through the Himalaya, it went to that, I'm forgetting the place name. Anyway, you look at the map, that this hilly range is continued even after Afghanistan, Caspian Sea or somewhere. It is going from there, it is again spreading. So this both way migration was there. Now it is four way migration, east to west, up to south. High altitude plants gradually coming down. Plants of low altitude gradually growing up. This is gradual adaptation. They are changing their adaptation, modifying their adaptation, and they are migrating more easily now. This is the condition. We permitted one foreigner to survive here. This is the Chinese tree in Mericaria. Then sometimes we introduced this plant, Cryptomeria japonica, locally called dhupi. You enter this forest. In the forest floor, you will find there is nothing. No other plant could survive. That is the tragedy of introduction of this. So our tea gardens, our dhupi plantation have replaced native vegetation, evicting thousands of local species of plants, animals from their own natural home. It was their home, but we evicted them. Remember, and we introduced some foreigner to occupy that place. I remember I used to visit this hillock in between Ghum and Sukhya Pukri on the left-hand side very frequently when I was in Darjeeling, because this hill was the home for numerous rare species of plants. But one day, that day, I was having one of my foreign students with me from Ohio State University, a lady. So when we were visiting that place, I found that entire hillock has been modified into a crop field. Where are those rare plants? They have vanished. Try to think. This is Mokokchung in Nagaland. When in 2001, I first visited this place, I found that it was a very small market area. But this photo is of 2011. You see how with so much of speed the city has enlarged. How concrete is eating away the green, eating away the forest. And after a few years, this city will grow far, far away, and it will destroy the vegetation of the entire area. So all other townships and cities are growing, and they will continue to destroy our vegetation. This photograph I was taken when one day I was, that was during August, so far I remember, I was descending to Jorhat Airport. So suddenly I noticed it, that all these natural drainage, people started farming. They are growing crop plants. After a few years, they will grow their houses on this. And after a few years, there will be heavy flood. People will scold the government. Government is not looking after our drainage, and we are suffering from flood. But they have destroyed the drainage, so they have to suffer. So we have to conserve everything, including our proposed drainage system. This is a grassland. People say grassland, that means there is nothing. Remove it. Make it a concrete forest. But remember, this is not a very simple area. This is Jallapara National Park, former rhino sanctuary. Unless there is nothing, then how this lady with cap, she is coming all the way from Utah State University. What she is doing here? Why US government gave her some good amount of dollar to work here? Why? If there is nothing, actually, these are very, very rich areas. We say this is protected area, Mahananda Wildlife Sanctuary. The place is meant for the wild animals and plants. Then why this has happened? Why this elephant is hit by this train? Why? You have conserved this place for wildlife. Don't say wildlife means only animals. Wildlife means both plants and animals. Then why you are removing vegetation, creating your broad roads and rail links, and that is destroying not only plants, animals, everything? Why? Why you are inviting conflict? Try to think. In this way, your conservation will not be successful. And this photo are from Jaldapada National Park. You see, these animals, look at their eyes. They don't trust you. They don't trust you. You say, no, we are conserving for you. But they never trust you. You are modifying something. You are permitting good number of tourists to enter there every day. So try to be careful. You see this thing at Bagdogra on 10th May 2007. They have poisoned this elephant. This elephant died of poisoning. They added poison. They provided food with poison. Elephant ate it and died. And after its death, people are worshipping it. If I am in power, I could have thrashed all these people. You are worshipping. You killed it and now you are worshipping. What nonsense you are. That is our country. We kill the snake, again we do Mansa Puja. What nonsense, I don't understand all these things. As a tourist, when you are moving as a tourist, you need to pay so many things, so much of money for your accommodation, for your movement, for your good food, everything. These three photographs are from the Singalila National Park. These photographs are taken by my student Upkar Rai. Upkar took these photos. So, Sandakpu is one well-known tourist place, Sandakpu Phalut. Every day, hundreds of people go there as tourists. Suppose one day, 1,000 people reached at Sandakpu. After arrival, what they need? Their first need will be one warm accommodation. Second thing will be warm food. Everything warm. But far from that, what will come? How many gas cylinders you can carry there? That is almost impossible. These are beautiful rhododendrons, local rhododendrons, native rhododendrons. They are cutting these rhododendrons, carrying those to the kitchen so that you can enjoy. You see, this is the science of your enjoyment. Sometimes we think of transboundary protection because one species is not surviving within one country. Think of the conservation of red panda. It is living in India, Tibet, Nepal, Bhutan. So we need a transboundary protected area. But it is very difficult. Procedure is so tough. In Africa, it is possible. Yeah, here we tried to do it. Here we tried to do it in this Kanchenjunga landscape, but we failed. Now you know about the hotspots. There are so far 35 recognized hotspots, of which 4 are within India. These red names are in India. You see, this is Himalaya hotspot. This is Indo-Burma hotspot. Mountains of South East China hotspots. All those hotspots are actually concentrated here. Why? This says that biodiversity of this region is too much rich. We need to conserve them. But how? These are our hotspots. Now let me take one small area. For West Bengal, I'm taking one very small area. Darjeeling Hills, Terai and Duars. Only within this region. Only with this region you see one Singalila biosphere reserve is in proposed condition for nearly 30 years or more. But there are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 national parks, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 wildlife sanctuaries already declared operating there, just in small area. Try to imagine how much is the biodiversity of this area. Unless the biodiversity is so rich of this area, why they will declare so many protected areas? Try to think. This is in Sikkim, same condition, in Assam, in Arunachal Pradesh, you see so many protected areas we declare, in Nepal, in Bhutan, you see it's a list, in Tibet, whatever may be, the actual biodiversity of all these protected areas is not known. We say it is there, but how much? What are actual plants and animals or microbes living there? We do not know it. Who can do this work? Only taxonomists can do this work. So for the sake of conservation, we need to sacrifice many of our present economic programs. Discard the construction roads. Discard the construction of this industry. Will you agree? If you agree, then conservation is possible. If you don't agree, then conservation is not possible. You see, this is one rough vegetation map of Darjeeling Hills. This is prepared in my own lab by Upkar Rai. Where is good vegetation cover? You take this map. This deep green portions are natural good vegetations. Then where is good vegetation, good natural forest in Darjeeling Hills? Everything is finished. We have finished everything. We tried to connect these four protected areas: Naurda Valley National Park, Mahananda Wildlife Sanctuary, Central Wildlife Sanctuary, Singalila National Park by corridors. By corridors, see these white areas are our protected corridors, but somehow we failed because we gave more importance to human habitat. Actually, government what want? We shall conserve one area, at the same time we shall earn from it. So this conservation and commercial exploitation cannot go hand in hand. It is impossible. We need real biodiversity lovers. One computer engineer or electronics engineer become the DFO. How he will look after the biodiversity? It is impossible. Attitude of local people, you the city dwellers, your attitude is different. When you are entering as a city dweller, when you are entering a national park with colorful dresses, your mobile is singing, your potato chips packet, all these things, these are all against the conservation. And this is the spillover of conservation. You see, even the lakes are burning. Lakes are burning in Mangalore. So these are the, see the plastic. See the plastic cover. You see, this 1.6 million square meter area, 1.6 million square meter area of the sea, is Pacific Ocean, is covered with polythene. How to save your biodiversity? One paper takes 1 month to decompose, and one plastic bag takes 10 lakh years to decompose. In some parties, you use thermocol plates. Why? I never accept thermocol plates in parties. I always refuse. Either I shall carry or I shall not take food. Or I shall say, okay, give me some food on my hand. I shall not accept thermocol. Please try to refuse. In market, try to refuse polythene. And at home or any place, you always refuse thermocol. This is just last year's condition. This year's condition, in January last year, November, December, then January, February, in Delhi, this oxygen kiosk, you have to survive like this with oxygen. We always throw everything to our rivers. After your Durga Puja is over, you will throw everything in rivers. That means you are polluting our river. Just look at this card. So whatever may be your faith or philosophy, it is not acceptable if it is not scientific. You have to prove that it is scientifically true, scientifically viable. Then we can accept it. Without scientific validity, I cannot go to accept any faith or any philosophy. That is why I don't believe in your Hindu, Muslim, Christian, etc. I understand only humanity. I don't believe it. See, this is the condition due to destruction of forest. There are some possibilities, some ideas in Kolkata also, few houses are there. You grow plants everywhere. You grow plants everywhere. You cover your house with plants also. There is one village like this where every house is plant covered. Actually, the conflict is between development and survival. This development, I call it negative development. With this negative development, you cannot survive. Either you stop this negative development or you have to die. Remember, we are thinking for medicinal plant conservation area. But anyway, there are plants, but at the same time, there are problems. Very near to Gorumara National Park, Lataguri, 5-star hotels. This will destroy the Gorumara National Park or Lataguri Reserve Forest, everything. Yeah, in Lataguri, for the construction of flyover, they are cutting Lataguri Forest, Reserve Forest. Thousands of trees they are felling. Local people protested, but who cares? I am having gun, I can control. Try to remember. Somehow, with my single-handed ability, I created this garden at North Bengal University. I don't know its present status, present conservation status, I don't know. But there are so many facilities. Over 800 species were there when I left. I don't know the present condition. I developed this society, East Himalayan Society for Spermatophyte Taxonomy. You can join our society. Here we publish our journal. This journal is not in the UGC list at this moment. Previously it was there, but I hope very soon it will return to UGC list. But our journal is always on date. It is never one day late even. We organize regular seminars, symposiums. We give awards. This year also we are going to give a number of awards very soon. We have already declared. So with that, thank you very much. Okay. If you like to contact, you can use this address.
Am I audible?
Yes, you are audible? Yes.
Thank you so much, sir. Such a powerful and excellent presentation. I mean, you have rocked the basis of this series where are we really ready to do biodiversity conservation is the biggest question that sir has put up. And I think it really needs a lot of thinking. And of course, sir, being a warrior of taxonomy, forever, and you have seen how much he has contributed, and we are so glad that sir will always be remembered. There are plants that are named after him by his students. So with that, thank you so much, sir. Out of your such a busy schedule, you have shared with us your knowledge. Thanks for that. And I asked I will take only two questions since we are really running out of time. We have a question from, I'm spelling it correctly. Lengyo Hoikip, he has asked that, sir, you have said that photography is not the way out, but if one had to take photographs, if one was in a sacred grove without a taxonomist, what are the things one should remember in a photograph for taxonomic importance?
You see, you need every detail, even leaf margin, leave below, hear some vain exile. Is it possible to take all photographs? You have to dissect the flower, take everything, even the nectar is inside, the attachment of anther, the hairiness of the filament towards the base, so many things. There are thousands of characters. When you identify a plant, we need to consider thousands of characters. And you are taking the photograph of a twig and asking us to identify the plant. Is it not?
Very challenging job. Very challenging job.
That is impossible. That is very impossible. Impossible work. Those who are replying to such questions, I say you should stop it. Don't do this work. Don't permit this type of work. Then it will damage your taxonomy. Okay.
Sure. Next. We will look more in details into taxonomy. And thank you for your answer, sir. We have a question from Shubhajit Bondopadhyay. He has asked, are there any legal restrictions for bringing plants from other countries?
Yes, of course. Even dry specimens you cannot take. Even dry specimens. Frankly speaking, I smuggled plants even from Australia. But I smuggled, frankly speaking. If I was caught, then certainly I was booked.
You would have been in trouble.
Yeah, certainly. But I smuggled.
Also.
Yeah. But that restriction should have there. That is also important. Without restrictions, we shall lose everything. Every day, there is smuggle through Chinese border, through Myanmar border, through Nepal border. Every day, our biodiversity is going out. We know it, but we cannot control it. It is very difficult to control because local people are involved with it. Okay.
Thank you for your answer, sir. Thank you, Shubhajit, for your question. We have many questions from Zoom as well as YouTube chat box, but due to paucity of time, I'm sorry, we won't be able to take up so many questions. We might forward your question.
I ask the audience, you please send a note to me if you like my lecture. Please send a note to me.
That's great. Thank you so much, sir. We'll ask them to do that. And now I move on we have completed our technical sessions. I'm asking my head of the department, Dr. Shuchishmita Chakraborty, to kindly deliver a vote of thanks.
Yes, thank you, Dr. Vishwarupa Ghosh. Am I audible?
Yes, you are audible.
Okay, thank you, sir. Vishwarupa Ghosh, you have been wonderful moderating the entire series. On behalf of the Department of Botany, I would like to extend my heartfelt thanks to one and all who have been the part of this international webinar series on biodiversity conservation and sustainable development issues. Now that we are at the fag end of this series, it's time to return thanks. At the very outset, I would like to extend my sincere gratitude to all the eminent speakers for accepting our invitation in spite of their busy schedule and also being from different time zones. Thank you again for enriching us with your illuminous talk and expertise on the subject and opening up new avenues to the students, and maybe they can take this up as their career or for higher studies also. I would also like to thank our participants who have been very supportive and encouraging throughout the webinar. I must now thank our principal ma'am, Professor Papia Chakraborty, for constant support and encouragement and giving us the platform where we could actually interact with people all around the world, share our thoughts during this time of the pandemic. I must also thank my esteemed colleagues from other colleges and university for taking their time out for attending the webinar. And also our students who actively participated and actually facilitated in many other ways, like preparing of the slide and then video shows, everything, and many other things. So thank you to our students also. And we are really proud of you, my dear students. Finally, I would like to thank each and every member of this organizing team. I think without their hard work and dedication, this webinar would not have been possible. And thank you all again. Thank you, Dr. Dipanshu Vishwas, for hosting the webinar series all these days. And I thank Dr. Vishwarupa Ghosh for moderating so well, moderating the entire program. I think she was very good. Thank you to Dr. Sangeeta Gangopadhyay for constantly acting as co-host and I think as joint convener of this event, entire event. And thanks goes to all other colleagues, Dr. Shapun Mondal, Dr. Priyanko Dhar, and Dr. Dinesh Haldar, who had been supporting this and who have been participating throughout this webinar. Thank you again, thanks to everyone once more. And finally, please stay safe, and I hope we'll meet again on this virtual platform some other day, some other time. Thank you again. Thank you all.
Thank you so much, Dr. Shuchishmita Chakraborty, for encouragement that you have given. It really motivates us to go ahead and probably organize many more webinars in coming days after a gap, because we are starting with our classes and examinations. And as you said, each and every organizing member has given so much of time, energy, in spite of the limitations of the pandemic, being at their homes, looking at their individual duties, families, and in spite of that, attending innumerable meetings and all other arrangements that needed to be done. Thank you so much, ma'am, for your encouragement. Thank you, Principal, ma'am, for all your support for making this happen. And I, lastly, but not the least, I call my colleague, Dr. Dipanshu Vishwas Kumar, to kindly give a sign off today's webinar. And on my part, on a personal note, I'm so grateful to each and every speaker for giving such valuable information and encouraging an entire generation, I would say, because there are so many students as participants to take up biodiversity conservation as a lifestyle and biodiversity conservation as a career goal. So thank you so much, each and every speaker, for the entire series. Thank you so much, each and every participant. I hand over to our host, Dr. Dipanshu Kumar Vishwa. Kindly sign off, sir.
Hello. Thank you, Dr. Before... Yes? Am I audible?
Yes, you're audible.
So thank you, Dr. Ghosh. Before officially closing today's meeting, I once again thank you all for your constant support and encouragement throughout this international webinar series. Your wholehearted participation was really a source of inspiration for all of us. Looking forward to get you all beside us on our future endeavor. So finally, I am wrapping up this meeting, acknowledging you all once again. Thank you, thank you, thank you.